External ear, middle ear. So, sounds, they are pressure waves that travel through air. Sounds are collected by the outer ear, and outer ear is also known as external ear. Okay? Sounds are collected by the external ear and channeled via the tympanic membrane, the eardrum. And they are channeled by tympanic membrane into the middle ear. And in middle ear, amplification occurs. They are channeled via the tympanic membrane into the middle ear for amplification by an articulating liver system. This articulating liver system consists of three ossicles, three small bones in the middle ear. They are malleus, incus, and stapes. The stapes transfer sound via the oval window to the cochlea, which is a part of the inner ear, for auditory transduction. Okay. The intensity or loudness of a sound is directly related to the amplitude of the sound waves and is measured in units called decibels. The ear of a trained young individual can hear sound over a frequency range of 20 to 20,000 Hz. This is important, okay? This usually comes in your MCQs. Ear of a trained young individual can hear over a frequency range of 20 to 20,000 Hz. Let's talk about the functional anatomy. The structure of the ear, the auditory system or ear can be divided into three main anatomical components. The outer ear, also known as external ear, middle ear and inner ear. I repeat, outer or external ear, middle ear and inner ear. Let's see in a picture. This portion, which consists of pinna, external auditory meatus, and the eardrum or the tympanic membrane, this much portion is known as outer ear or external ear. And its main function is to collect and funnel the sounds. Now, the portion beyond the tympanic membrane up to here is known as middle ear. You can see middle ear. Its main function is to amplify the sound. Middle ear consists of three tiny bones. One, they are called ossicles. They are called malleus. Malleus, you can see this malleus is attached with the tympanic membrane. Incus, this second bone. Incus is attached to malleus. And incus is another end is attached to stapes bone. Foot plate of the stapes is attached to the inner ear. Okay. So, there are three pieces of small bones which are known as ossicles, which are present in the middle ear. And there is a tube from middle ear going. This tube's name is Eustachian tube or tubotympanic tube. Okay, this is Eustachian tube. Could you follow? The inner ear's function is it helps in hearing and balance. Okay, so the main function, the main functional anatomy that we are studying here is the external ear. It collects and funnels the sounds. Consists of pinna, external auditory meatus, tympanic membrane. Then the middle ear. Middle ear starts beyond the tympanic membrane and it consists of three small bones which are known as malleus, incus and stapes. These are known together as ossicles. There is a tube which is connecting to the nasopharynx. This is called Eustachian tube. And there are muscles, two muscles. One is stapedius and another is tensor tympani, which is not shown in this picture, but we'll see it in another picture. Okay. And this middle ear's main function is amplification of the sound. And cochlea is the inner ear. Cochlea in the inner ear and vestibular apparatus. Their main function is hearing and balance. Let's see. The outer ear or the external ear, the pinna collects and focuses the sound. I hope you remember this is the pinna, the outer portion, this bigger portion. The pinna collects and focuses the sounds. Sounds are channeled into the ear, that is external auditory meatus, which allows them to pass through the skull bone, through the skull's temporal bone. Okay, the canal ends blindly at the tympanic. The canal ends blindly at the tympanic membrane, that is eardrum. An eardrum vibrates in response to sound. Could you appreciate that? It receives and collects the sound. The sound wave goes and it hits the eardrum, that is the tympanic membrane. Okay. Then let's talk about middle ear. Middle ear is an ear-filled chamber lying between eardrum and the inner ear. See? Middle ear is an ear-filled chamber lying between the external ear and the inner ear. Would you follow? It connects with the nasopharynx via the Eustachian tube. See here, this middle ear is connected with the nasopharynx by Eustachian tube, which drains the fluids and allows the pressure across the eardrum's two surfaces to equalize. This Eustachian tube drains the fluid and it helps to equalize the pressure between the two surfaces of the tympanic membrane. That means the pressure in the external ear and the pressure inside the middle ear, they are kept equal by the help of Eustachian tube. Okay, so let's see it again. It connects. The middle ear is an ear-filled chamber lying between the eardrum, that is tympanic membrane, and the inner ear. Middle ear connects with the nasopharynx via the Eustachian tube, which drains the fluids and allows the pressure across the eardrum's two surfaces to equalize. Eardrum vibrations are transmitted to the inner ear by an articulating lever system comprising of three small fragile bones called ossicles. Eardrum vibrations are transmitted to the inner ear by an articulating lever system comprising of three small fragile bones called ossicles. See, here in the picture we have seen these three bones, three pieces of bones, malleus, incus and stapes, small bones, together known as ossicles. The vibration, the sound vibration that is received by tympanic membrane is transmitted to ossicles, malleus, incus and stapes. Okay. The bones are known as malleus. Malleus is, it looks like hammer. Okay, malleus looks like hammer. It is attached with tympanic membrane. Then incus is also known as anvil. Incus is also known as anvil and stapes is also known as stirrup. These names roughly reflecting their shapes. So the ossicles, what are they? Ossicles are malleus, incus and stapes. Malleus, incus and stapes. It looks like hammer like anvil and stirrup. So what is the function of these ossicles? These ossicles, they receive the sound from the tympanic membrane and they amplify the sound vibration. They act as a lever system. Okay, they are an articulating lever system. Malleus is attached to the eardrum's inner surface, and it transmits the vibration to the incus. You see in the picture, malleus, it is attached to the inner surface of the eardrum or tympanic membrane, and it transmits the vibration received by the tympanic membrane. The vibration is transmitted to incus. Okay. Another ossicle. Then the malleus is attached to the eardrum's inner surface and transmits vibrations to the incus. The incus transmits them to the stapes. The stapes foot plate inserts into and is firmly attached to the oval window of the inner ear. The incus transmits them to the stapes. Means see here, the vibration that is coming in the eardrum or the tympanic membrane, that vibration is received by malleus. Malleus transmits that vibration to incus, and from incus that is transmitted to stapes. That is, from the sound vibration from tympanic membrane is transmitted to malleus, incus and stapes, the three ossicles which act as a lever system. They act as a articulating lever system. Okay. After that, What we need to know is the inner ear. Inner ear is responsible for hearing and balance. Okay. Let's talk about the ossicles and their role in impedance matching. Let's see again what we were talking about. Number one, this is the tympanic membrane, pearl-like color, and this is tympanic membrane. When we see with the otoscope, examine the tympanic membrane with the otoscope, we see it looks like the color of a pearl. The sound waves that come, the sound waves, they vibrate the eardrum. That is, the sound waves will vibrate the tympanic membrane. Then what happens? The tympanic membrane is attached, and the malleus is attached to the tympanic membrane. Malleus is attached to incus, and incus is attached to stapes, the three ossicles, isn't it? The ossicles. So see, number two, the malleus is attached to and moves with the eardrums. So when sound wave vibrates the eardrum, when sound wave vibrates the tympanic membrane, it also vibrates the malleus. Then the incus amplifies the sound, amplifies the movement. Okay, the incus amplifies the movements. Then the number four is the stapes focuses the movements on a small area. The stapes, what does it do? Stapes is an ossicle. It focuses the movements on a small area. It focuses the movement on a small area, that is on a foot plate, and transmits them to the oval window. Okay, so this is how the ossicles do their work. Let's repeat. Sound waves vibrate the eardrum, that is the tympanic membrane. Then the ossicles, the malleus, which is attached to and moves with the eardrum. Okay, then incus amplifies the movement. Then the stapes focuses the movements on a small area. That is, it focuses the movement on a small area, which is foot plate, and transmits this movements to the oval window. Okay. Now let's see what is impedance matching. The impedance matching, the inner ear. Let me tell you, this topic is very, 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 very important for your examination. Okay. From ear chapter, impedance matching is the most important, is one of the most important topics. Impedance matching, the inner ear is filled with fluid that has a high inertia and is difficult to move compared with air. Because we know that middle ear is air filled, inner ear is fluid filled. Okay, the middle ear is air filled, this is air filled cavity, but inner ear is fluid filled cavity. Okay, so the inner ear is filled with fluid that has a high inertia and is difficult to move compared with air. The middle ear's function is thus to harness the sound waves' inherent energy and transmit it to the inner ear with sufficient force to overcome the inertia of the fluid contents. Please listen carefully. What does the middle ear do? The middle ear's function is to harness the sound waves' inherent energy. It harnesses the sound waves' inherent energy and transmits it to the inner ear with sufficient force to overcome the inertia of the fluid contents. Okay, this process is called impedance matching. What is the mechanism of impedance matching? Let's see. The ossicles, that is the malleus, incus and stapes present in the middle ear, they form a lever system. They form a lever system that amplifies the tympanic membrane movements or the eardrum movements by 30%. Please remember, the ossicles, that is the malleus, incus and stapes, they form a lever system, and this lever system amplifies the eardrum movements. It amplifies the eardrum movements by 30%. This is one mechanism. Another is, it also focuses the movements on the stapes foot plate. It focuses the movements on the stapes foot plate, whose surface area is 17 times smaller than the surface area of the eardrum or the tympanic membrane. The second important mechanism is the ossicle focuses the movements on the stapes foot plate. It focuses the movements on the stapes foot plate, and stapes foot plate's surface area is 17 times smaller than the surface area of the tympanic membrane. Amplification and focusing combined increase force per unit area 22-fold. Okay, so there is amplification. First there is amplification, then there is focusing. So amplification and focusing combined increase the force per unit area. They increase the force per unit area how many times? 22 times. So it increases the amplification and focusing combined increase the force per unit area 22 times, which allows sounds to be transferred to the inner ear with sufficient force to overcome cochlear fluid inertia. Okay, if you have understood, fine. If you have not understood, then I am repeating this one. Impedance matching. See, impedance matching, we know that the middle ear is ear filled and the inner ear is fluid filled. Okay, so the inner ear is filled with fluid that has a high inertia and is difficult to move compared with air. The middle ear's function is to harness the sound wave's inherent energy and transmit it to the inner ear with sufficient force to overcome the inertia of the fluid contents. Okay, and transmit it to the inner ear with sufficient force to overcome the inertia of the fluid contents. This process is called impedance matching. Then we have to know the mechanism of impedance matching. The mechanism is the malleus, incus and stapes, they form a lever system. Okay, and this amplifies the tympanic membrane movements, eardrum movements. It amplifies the eardrum movements by how much? By 30%. So ossicles, they form a lever system and they amplify the eardrum or the tympanic membrane movement by 30%. Then another point is, the ossicles also focus the movements on the stapes foot plate. It also focuses the movements on the stapes foot plate. And the surface area of the stapes foot plate is 17 times smaller than the eardrum. Okay. The surface area of the stapes foot plate. See here, with the help of cursor, I'm showing you. The surface area of the stapes foot plate is around 17 times smaller than the surface area of the tympanic membrane. Isn't it? So it focuses the movements on the stapes foot plate, whose surface area is 17 times smaller than the eardrum. So amplification and focusing combined increase force per unit area. Okay, the amplification, the first point, amplification and then focusing combinedly, these two increase the force per unit area. How many times? 22 times, 22 fold. So what happens because of the amplification and focusing combinedly, they increase the force per unit area 22 folds. This allows sounds to be transferred to the inner ear with sufficient force to overcome the cochlear fluid inertia. Okay, this is the mechanism of impedance matching. See, a person in water cannot hear sound produced out of it, isn't it? 99.9% sound get reflected from the surface of water due to impedance. So as air-filled middle ear conducts sound to the fluid-filled inner ear, most of the sound get reflected, which is called impedance mismatching. This is compensated by inner ear by impedance matching. So there are mainly three mechanisms by which impedance matching occurs. Let's see. The hydraulic action of tympanic membrane. Effective vibratory area of the tympanic membrane is around 50 millimeter square. This is much more than stapes oval window surface area, which is 3.2 millimeter square. You can compare the area. This is tympanic membrane is around 50 millimeter square, And the stapes area is around, foot plate of stapes area is around 3.2 millimeters. So the force produced by sound concentrated over small area. The force that is produced by sound concentrates over small area. See, the larger area is here in the tympanic membrane. So the force is like this. Now this goes to a smaller area, and when there is smaller area, there is higher pressure depicted by the pencil hill. See here. So there is higher pressure. So effective vibratory area of tympanic membrane is around 50 millimeters square, and this is much more than the area of the stapes, which stapes oval window, which is 3.2 millimeters square. So force produced by sound concentrated over small area. Okay. There is much more force produced by sound which is concentrated over small area. Now amplifying pressure on oval window. It amplifies the pressure on the oval window. So this is one mechanism we must remember, the area ratio. The area of the tympanic membrane to the stapes, we must remember. Okay. After that, the impedance matching of ear of impedance matching by ear ossicles. The another mechanism, let's see, lever action of vesicles. The ossicles, what they do is the handle of the malleus, see here, the handle of the malleus is 1.3 times longer than the long process of incus. This handle of the malleus, which is attached to the tympanic membrane, this handle of the malleus is 1.3 times longer than the process of incus, which is this one. The process of incus is 1.3 times smaller than the handle of malleus. Okay, this provides mechanical leverage system. So it looks just like the lever actions shown here in the sheet saw. Okay, so ossicles increase force of movement by 1.3 times. So the ossicles, they increase these bones, malleus, incus and stapes, they increase the movement, force of movement by 1.3 times. So there are two things that we should remember. One is the ratio of diameter of tympanic membrane and the diameter of oval window. It is around 21:1. Another is ossicles increase, the handle of the malleus is 1.3 times longer than the process of incus. And this provides mechanical leverage system. Okay, so ossicles increase force of movement by 1.3 times. It increases the force of movement by 1.3 times. This is the second mechanism. Now coming to the third mechanism. Tympanic membrane is a curved membrane. Okay, the movement of the tympanic membrane is more at periphery than at center, where malleus is attached. In the center, malleus is attached. Okay, so this provides some lever action. Okay, so curved membrane effect, movement of tympanic membrane more at periphery than at center where malleus is attached, so provides some leverage. So all these together increase sound pressure 22 folds. So impedance mismatching is mostly compensated, and if we remove the ossicles, loud sounds will be heard as a whisper. Okay, could you follow this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now let's talk about the attenuation reflex. Again, let's see the picture of middle ear. The middle ear has got, we have talked about the ossicles, the three bones. This is the malleus, this is the incus, and this is the stapes. Now let's talk about the muscle, tensor tympani muscle, which is present there. Okay, and let's talk about stapedius muscle. Okay, and facial motor nerve, it supplies these muscles, and the branch of the trigeminal nerve supplies the tensor tympani. Okay, this is the trigeminal motor nerve supplying the tensor tympani. We must remember tensor tympani muscle gets nerve supply from a branch of the fifth cranial nerve, trigeminal cranial nerve. Okay, whereas stapedius muscle, it is getting its nerve supply from the branch of the seventh cranial nerve, that is facial motor nerve. Okay, after that, let's talk about attenuation reflex, what it is. We should know that tensor tympani muscle and stapedius muscle, when they contract, they limit the movement of the ossicles. When tensor tympani and stapedius, they contract, these muscles contract, they limit the ossicle movement. And when they limit the movement of the ossicles, that is malleus, incus and stapes, the movement is limited. This dampens the sound transmission. Okay. So attenuation reflex is also known as tympanic reflex or acoustic reflex. It is a protective reflex. Okay. It is a protective reflex. What does it do? It reduces the sound pressure amplitude by changing the mobility and transmission properties of ear ossicles. This is what we studied here, isn't it? Tensor tympani and stapedius muscle contraction limits the ossicle movement and dampens the sound transmission. Attenuation reflex, the stimulus is a loud sound. Latent period of attenuation reflex is 40 to 80 milliseconds. Okay. For example, sudden loud sound or bomb explosion can lead to deafness. Reflex activity, contraction of two muscles occur, tensor tympani and stapedius. Latent period means attenuation reflex can act only beyond 80 milliseconds. Okay, it cannot act when the sound has occurred very quickly, within 40 to 80 milliseconds. If the sound has occurred, a very loud sound has occurred within 40 to 80 seconds, which is the latent period of this reflex, then deafness can occur. Okay. Reflex activity is, there is contraction of the two muscles, tensor tympani, which is supplied by fifth cranial nerve, that is trigeminal cranial nerve, and stapedius, which is supplied by facial nerve. Okay. After that, so with this thing in background, let's talk about damping. The lever system flexibility is modulated to reduce sound amplitude under certain circumstances. The malleus and stapes are attached to two tiny muscles under autonomic control. The malleus and stapes are attached to two tiny muscles under autonomic control. See, malleus is attached to a tiny muscle, tensor tympani, which is supplied by fifth cranial nerve, trigeminal nerve, and stapes is attached to a tiny muscle called stapedius, which is supplied by seventh cranial nerve, that is facial cranial nerve, isn't it? After that, the lever system flexibility is modulated to reduce sound amplitude under certain circumstances. The malleus and stapes are attached to two tiny muscles under autonomic control. The tensor tympani anchors the malleus to the wall of the middle ear and is innervated by the trigeminal nerve, that is the fifth cranial nerve. Stapes is anchored by the stapedius muscle, which is innervated by the facial nerve or the cranial nerve 7. When these two muscles contract, the ossicular chain becomes more rigid and sound transmission is attenuated. The attenuation reflex can be triggered by loud sounds, but is probably designed to dampen the sound of our own voices when talking. Okay. So attenuation reflex, let's see it again. Tensor tympani. See, this is a malleus, this is incus, and this is stapes. This is a muscle, tensor tympani muscle. Okay. And this is the stapedius muscle. So tensor tympani pulls the malleus inwards. Tensor tympani, this muscle, pulls the malleus inwards. And stapedius, that is this one, stapedius pulls the stapes outwards. Stapedius muscle pulls the stapes outwards. Okay. Both makes ossicular system rigid and no vibrations occur. Okay. When tensor tympani and stapedius contract, they both make the ossicular system, that is The ossicular system means malleus, incus, and stapes together. They make this system rigid. They make ossicular system rigid and no vibrations occur. Sound intensity is decreased by 30 to 40 decibel. Okay, sound intensity gets decreased by 30 to 40 decibels. What are the advantages of attenuation reflex? It prevents damage to cochlea, which is inner ear, from loud sound. It attenuates and masks all low frequency environmental sounds and allows person to concentrate on sounds above 1000 Hz. It reduces sound produced during vocalization and chewing. Okay, so these are the advantages of attenuation reflex. What are they? One is it prevents damage to cochlea from loud sound. Another, it attenuates and masks all low frequency environmental sounds and allows a person to concentrate on sounds above 1000 Hz. It reduces the sound produced during vocalization and chewing. Okay, could you follow this?
Yes, ma'am.
In today's lecture, impedance matching, attenuation reflex, these are quite important. Okay. Now let's talk about Eustachian tube. Do you remember this or you have forgotten? Let's see the picture and remind ourselves what is Eustachian tube. Eustachian tube. Okay, this tube, Eustachian tube, it connects the middle ear and the nasopharynx. Okay, so what does Eustachian tube do? Eustachian tube is a passageway which leads from the middle ear to the nasopharynx. Nasopharynx is a cavity positioned behind the nasal cavity and extends down to the soft palate. The auditory tube, Eustachian tube, is also known as auditory tube. Okay, Eustachian tube is also known as auditory tube. The auditory tube is usually collapsed so that debris and infectious agents are prevented from traveling from the oral cavity to the middle ear. Okay, in normal conditions, auditory tube is collapsed. So the debris and the infectious agents do not travel from oral cavity to the middle ear. Now, in order to open the auditory tube, the tensor tympani muscle attaching the auditory tube and the malleus must contract. Okay, let's see the picture and try to understand. In order to open the auditory tube, the tensor tympani muscle attached to the auditory tube and malleus. The tensor tympani muscle has to contract. The tensor tympani muscle has to contract. You can see with the cursor, the tensor tympani muscle, this one, which is attached to the malleus, and let's see how it works. The auditory tube, so that debris and infectious agents are prevented from traveling from the oral cavity to the middle ear. In order to open the auditory tube, the tensor tympani muscle, which is attaching the auditory tube and the malleus, must contract. Okay, which attaches the auditory tube and the malleus. Auditory tube, also known as Eustachian tube, and the malleus must contract. This auditory tube So, when does this open? When does this contract? It contracts when we are swallowing, when we are yawning, when we are sneezing. At that time, the auditory tube or the Eustachian tube opens how? By contraction of the tensor tympani muscle, which is attached to the auditory tube and the malleus. So this occurs during swallowing, yawning and sneezing. People sense a popping sensation in their ears as they swallow when driving up a mountain, because the opening of the auditory canal permits air to move from the region of higher pressure in the middle ear. Okay. To the region of the lower pressure in the nasopharynx. Okay. People sense a popping sound in the ears as they swallow when driving up a mountain, because the opening of the auditory canal permits air to move from the region of higher pressure in the middle ear to the region of the lower pressure in the nasopharynx. It equalizes the pressure between the middle ear and the external ear. Okay, now let's see about the pictures. Again, let's see the picture of ear. This is the external ear, pinna, and then external auditory meatus, and then this is the tympanic membrane or pearl. Pearl colored tympanic membrane, also known as eardrum. This one, it's also known as eardrum. Then the middle ear cavity is there, isn't it? So this is a view of the middle ear. In this middle ear, what are they? They are three muscles: malleus, which is attached to the behind the eardrum, which is present behind the eardrum, middle ear. The malleus is attached behind the middle, behind the tympanic membrane in the middle ear. And malleus is one of the ossicles. The another one is incus, and then another one is stapes. Okay, and there is a tube connecting the middle ear and the nasopharynx, which is known as auditory canal or auditory tube or Eustachian tube. Okay, it is known as auditory tube or Eustachian tube. So this much for today. You have any questions, class?
No, ma'am.